here in the US. So please, sorry if it gets too crazy with legal words. But I'm also going to say that a lot of information that I'm presenting today, it's really, I'm going to be using some legal terms, and a lot of it, you know, I don't always disagree, and I'm sure a lot of people don't always disagree with the words that the government uses to define people, and the types of immigrant statuses that folks end up having, or how they're here in the U.S., etc. But I'm going to definitely be using some of those words that are used within the immigration system, within our government, and within the law. But at the end of the presentation, I will be going over some of the legislation that has kind of been laws for a really long time. Some that we don't really have, some that have been changed quite a bit, but some of the legal terms that are still used today. So before I begin, I will present myself. I'm trying to put my battery down. So my name is Sahira Barajas, and I'm the AmeriCorps Business Dreamer Support Navigator here at Seattle Central. I'm based out of the Multicultural Services Office. And again, my work really focuses on undocumented students here on campus. So if you all ever need some assistance with that, I am here to help.
You may have to aim it at the computer itself, but
okay, there you go. Sorry, yeah. Okay, so this is a little bit about what I mentioned, right? So these are kind of the five things that I really wanted to talk about. One of them is explaining immigration statuses a bit, then explaining a little bit about the population breakdown from the national level up to the local level, explaining a little bit about benefits or program eligibility for undocumented folks primarily, again from the federal level to the state level, talking a little bit about rights, based on immigration status. And then the last thing is impactful legislation, mostly at the federal level, the things that have happened over the course of the foundation of the U.S. And so the first thing I'm going to talk about is the immigration. We're explaining a little bit immigration status. So there really, through the government, there really is two different types of statuses that folks are able, that fall into primarily. So one of them is anyone who is an immigrant. And this is the part that I mentioned earlier, that a lot of the terms that the government uses are like illegal alien, illegal immigrant, alien. And oftentimes that's the term that is defined within a lot of laws and a lot of other information that the government puts out. But in general, it's folks who are immigrants, right? Coming from a country outside of the U.S., wanting to resettle here in the U.S. And so part of the immigrant population, it could be a wide range of these folks. Like I said, I'm primarily going to be focusing on undocumented immigrants. So it's our folks, those are folks who do not have authorization from the government to come and resettle themselves in the country. And that includes DACA recipients. How many of you have heard of the DACA program? Yeah. So with DACA recipients, they're still considered undocumented because the DACA program doesn't change someone's immigration status, right? Under immigrant too, there's a variety of visas, refugees, asylum seekers, lawful permanent residents, and then U.S. citizens through the naturalization process. So anyone who wasn't born within the boundaries of the country or their parents are U.S. citizens, then they're able to naturalize through the U.S. Naturalization process and become U.S. citizens. So these are kind of the statuses of folks, you know, moving here. And then we also have a process for non-immigrants, and that's for anyone intending to come to the U.S. on a temporary basis. So that includes visas for board for students and tourist visas as well. And so those are kind of the two main categories that we have. The next thing is a little bit about how someone becomes undocumented, right? And so through these processes, there's, through all of these processes, there's a way that folks are able to apply to the government to be able to resettle themselves here. Undocumented folks, that's a group that does not have a path to citizenship, a path to naturalization, or even a path to having lawful permanent residency here in the U.S., right? So the way that most people come are through these three types of ways, right? So either someone entered the U.S. with fraudulent documents, they came into the U.S. without inspection, meaning they crossed the border, one of the many borders that we have here in the U.S., or they entered the country legally with a work, student, or tourist visa, and they overstayed their time here in the U.S. as well. So this is and so next we're going to go into a little bit about the population breakdown. The Department of Homeland Security is the agency that kind of oversees a lot of this, a lot of the immigration related things. So they put out a report. They don't really do it on an annual basis, but it is consistent of folks coming into the country and folks who are not accounted for. And so in this report specifically, they estimated that most folks were from Mexico who were here unauthorized, and it accounted for 6.7 million people, although that number has started to decrease because folks from other countries are coming into the U.S. or folks are coming with visas and overstaying their time. And so, of course, it shifts over time. But right now, these numbers are fairly accurate still, with Mexico being the top country of origin. And we will see why also much later in the presentation of why that is, right? So the next thing is that the same DHS report reports that most undocumented folks live in California, with 2.8 million folks living in the state of California. And then Washington ranks about number 10 to number 11, depending on the year. But you really see the difference, right? There's a really major difference going from like millions to just a few hundred thousand. And then this is just for the undocumented population, right? And so I think it's important to kind of look at where people settle here in the U.S. because then that informs the government of where resources are allocated, specifically like language resources. Folks come from a variety of countries and speak a variety of languages. But also that most folks end up settling in the southern border states. But the populations from every state are very different as well. In Florida, I know that there's a lot of folks from the Caribbean, like Jamaica, Haiti, Cuba. And then in California, you see a lot of folks from Mexico, but a lot of Central Americans as well, from El Salvador, Guatemala. And so even looking at the populations for each state is very different as well. And so these are kind of the national populations. So next we're going to go to the state of Washington, because we live here, and just kind of learning a little bit about what's happening here. And so, again, the same Department of Homeland Security report ranked Washington State as the 10th largest population of undocumented folks. And again, as I said earlier, it's very different from the 2.8 million folks, right? But again, this is just accounting for the undocumented population, not accounting like refugees, asylum seekers, folks who come here with visas, et cetera, but it's still a significant number. The Department of Homeland Security hasn't officially put out a report with this information, but a lot of community organizations that do assess the census, or the ACS, which is the American Community Survey, that are put out annually to kind of get an assessment of the population. Some of those reports have stated that some of the top countries of origin for the state of Washington are Mexico, Guatemala, India, Vietnam, and Korea. There really isn't a differentiation between North and South Korea in some of these reports, but these are kind of the top five countries of origin of some folks who are here unauthorized in the state of Washington. And so kind of going a little bit more about the population of the state of Washington. So since 2012, the population has increased quite a bit. Just some kind of side reading that I did on my own was, since 2012, this is the population increase, 365,000. And that really has been for a variety of reasons. There has been a large migration from folks coming from other states, primarily from California, Oregon, and Texas. But we have had a kind of larger number of refugees coming into the state of Washington. And again, folks, even folks who are undocumented, who settle themselves in a different state and then end up moving to the state of Washington, has also kind of impacted the population growth here in the state. And the other thing that I saw was that most of the population in the state of Washington is within these counties, which is Pierce, King, and Snohomish County. And so they're mostly within this area. And so that's where you really see the population growth of a variety of populations. The next thing that I wanted to talk about is that the city of Seattle also reports a lot of this information, as does the county. The one from the city of Seattle I wanted to highlight because I think it was really well put out and it looks nice and really cool information. And so some of the things that the city of Seattle has put out is not specifically to undocumented folks or not specifically to refugees, but folks who are foreign born, so anyone who wasn't born in the U.S. would have a variety of statuses. And so they accounted that within 2014, about 113,000 folks were foreign born within the city limits. And they also have top countries of origin. And some of them kind of are similar to the national and to the statewide ones, China, Vietnam, Mexico, South Korea, and India. And so they kind of have some of this information available for everyone to take a look at where folks, or who makes up the population within the city. So I kind of wanted to share a little bit. They do have more in-depth information, but I wanted to share this report, which is available for everyone to access on the city website. So definitely seeing the kind of, trends of folks from the national to each state and then at the local level, right? Was that helpful? Did you all kind of get a sense of folks? I know I'm going through it a little fast. I always tell people, I memorize so much of this that I feel like I talk really fast when I present. But anyways, so the next thing that I'm going to talk about are some barriers. So again, specifically to undocumented folks, because undocumented folks are not eligible for a lot of federal and state programs. And here specifically, I'm going to talk about the programs that folks are not eligible at the federal level. And a lot of programs are federally funded and federally managed, so folks are not able to apply to programs like food stamps, health insurance, some unemployment benefits, even for some housing like Section 8 or project-based housing that folks are not eligible to apply to because you need to have a social security number or they're strictly for U.S. citizens or lawful permanent residents. The primary one here, since we're at a college, is financial aid that undocumented folks are not eligible to apply for the federal financial aid, which is really significant in coming to school, right? But some things that folks are eligible to apply to, but the list, of course, is a lot shorter, or some of these things at the federal level, K-12 public education, folks are still able to file taxes if they're undocumented, own a business and things like that. And then at the state level,
Undocumented students are eligible to apply for in-state tuition, state financial aid, and undocumented folks in general are able to apply for driver's licenses and IDs. And so those are some opportunities that, that are still available for folks to apply to, right? The other thing that I did want to talk about is kind of knowing your rights type of things, because in talking about immigrant rights, and there's a lot of things that folks are excluded from, but constitutional rights is something that applies to everyone who lives within the boundaries of the U.S. And so kind of knowing your rights in terms of, you know, if you're approached by law enforcement out in the street, or even if someone comes to your home or anything like that, these are some things that are important to know. You know, like you have the right to remain silent, you have the right to ask questions if you're being detained or not. If you did something, you have the right to an attorney if you can't afford one. So these are all part of the constitutional rights that everyone has. The immigration system law does work a bit differently, and the right to an attorney if you can't afford one doesn't apply to immigration court. So anyone who is detained for an immigration-related issue are not eligible to have an attorney present. So folks have to pay out of pocket, but for the most part, folks end up going to court without an attorney present, and usually represent themselves. So some of these stuff is important. So I'm gonna leave some of these Know Your Rights cards for you all to take. I have them in English and in a few other languages, but definitely the ACLU has been a really great resource to passing out information like this. So you can download these sheets from the ACLU and have them for your records. And so this is the part that I wanted to talk about in terms of the immigration system. So the immigration system is very, very large and very complicated, but it has changed over the years. Some of the top agencies, I know it's going to be kind of hard to read, but some of the top agencies from the immigration system are the Department of Homeland Security, which is the agency that primarily oversees immigration issues, and then the Department of Justice, which oversees the courts. So I'm going to go through every single agency just so you all kind of get an idea of what each agency does. So USCIS, which is the Citizenship and Immigration Services, they process most of the paperwork. So if you want to apply, for example, for a visa or for refugee status, that you'll go through them once you're in the U.S. The State Department is the one that does a lot of that work abroad, if you're filing from your own country, or if you're at a refugee camp in a different country abroad, then you would go to the State Department. But USCIS does a lot of that paperwork, and they also do a lot of advocacy and a lot of information sharing. And so, for example, folks who had DACA and had to apply for the work permit, they would go through USCIS. And then the next agency is the U.S. Customs and Border Protection folks. So those you usually see, the customs agents, you usually see them at airports or any other ports of entry that we have here in the U.S. Border protection folks are usually the folks who are at the land borders protecting the countries or managing the countries and being present in those areas. Whereas the U.S. Coastal Guard are the folks who are around all of the waterway borders. And so this is one thing that I definitely learned that I didn't know, because the Coast Guard is usually seen as a kind of, I thought it was under the military or the Department of Defense, but they're actually under the Department of Homeland Security. So they do some of that stuff there. The next one is Immigration and Custom Enforcement, which is ICE. They're the law enforcement of the Department of Homeland Security. Oftentimes they identify themselves as police whenever they're in cities or different areas, but they are different than the local police. And so sometimes they'll have ICE, and sometimes they'll just have police, but it's good to kind of differentiate who they are. So the police, the ICE does a lot of work similar to what police do, is investigate certain cases, but these are just strictly to immigration issues. And so they'll gather evidence and all of that, and then once they're ready to take someone to court based on the immigration issue, then they would go to the Justice Department, to the immigration court, right? And then the last office that I wanted to highlight is the Office of the General Counsel. And so they're basically the attorneys for the Department of Homeland Security. And they're the folks who also, with ICE, they work together, and then they take folks to the immigration courts, right? So, as I mentioned, and so through the immigration courts, there is only a handful of them. There isn't too many across the country. There are 57 courts in 27 states, and then two U.S. commonwealths. And basically, what folks do at the immigration courts is to determine if somebody's going to stay within the U.S. or if they're going to be deported. The other part that I didn't talk about too much, but that the Department of Homeland Security kind of oversees, are detention centers. So the detention centers are different from local jails or anything like that. And the detention centers are strictly for immigration-related purposes. The Department of Homeland Security doesn't actually oversee most of the detention centers. They're usually subcontracted to private organizations to oversee the detention centers, although there is some presence of ICE in some of the detention centers. And we do have one here in the state of Washington, and it's in Tacoma. It's called the Tacoma Northwest Detention Center. And so you definitely end up seeing some of the immigration courts in states where there's large populations, as I mentioned earlier, right? So like California, Texas, New York is actually one of the states that has a large number of immigration courts as well. And similar to detention centers, like you mostly see them in areas where the population of undocumented folks are the largest. And so I kind of wanted to do an overview of that. And so the next thing that I'm going to get into is some impactful legislation that has happened over the years. And so I'm taking it back to 1790, you know, which is some time ago. But just to really see that there's been, there's trends over the years of some of this legislation. So it's not something like very recent, you know, that has happened the last 25 years, right? So the first thing that I wanted to highlight was the Chinese Exclusion Act, which passed in 1882. And so that basically banned Chinese laborers from coming to the U.S. So as many of you, I'm sure, have studied U.S. history, you know, when the country was founded, a lot of folks from Africa were forced to come to the U.S. as slaves, right? And so with this, the U.S. really didn't want other folks to come into the country to do some of the work that they were already facilitating. And so this legislation was really kind of a call for that, you know? And so it banned Chinese laborers, and it prohibited Chinese folks from naturalizing, and people were seen as undesirable here in the U.S. The next thing is, in 1906, the Naturalization Act, it removed kind of the Department of Commerce and Labor to do immigration-related things to the Bureau of Immigration and Naturalization. And it also said that only English-speaking immigrants were able to naturalize or to come to the U.S. To resettle themselves here from, you know, a variety of countries that they were coming from. In 1924, we passed the Immigration Act, and this put a cap on the number of folks who could come from particular countries, but it definitely did not include countries from the Western Hemisphere, so mostly Latin American countries. So people were still able to go back and forth from their country or resettle themselves here in the U.S. During that time. And of course, I mean, the other thing that I wanted to mention is during times of war, you know, whoever we're at war with, those are the people that we end up kind of not always banning, but as well putting caps on where folks can come from and all of that. So the other thing that I wanted to point out was in 1943, the U.S. had a program called the Bracero Program because of the shortage of folks during the war. During World War II, we needed agricultural workers to work the fields for us to be able to have food. And so it was basically a program with Mexico to allow folks from Mexico to come as temporary workers, and then folks would be able to go back to Mexico, or some folks would be able to stay here. But it was specifically for that. And so I definitely have met folks who whose grandparents or great-grandparents are part of this program, and who are now have had generations of U.S. Citizen family members. The next thing that I wanted to point out was in 1986, we had the Immigration Reform and Control Act. And this is kind of one of the first times that the government put sanctions on employers to not hire anyone who was considered undocumented. And a lot of these laws, for the most part, they use illegal aliens or purchased aliens. And so to discourage employers from hiring anyone who was not a U.S. citizen or came to the country through the legal pathway, they put some sanctions to businesses and companies and things like that. But at the same time, it also granted amnesty to a lot of folks who were already here undocumented. And so in 1986, anyone who had entered the country before 1982 was able to apply for a green card. And so that was a really big thing that that passed in 1986. And then more recently, in 2012, the Homeland Security Act. And so this era is considered post 9/11 time. And so the Homeland Security Act created the Department of Homeland Security. So as we know, so in 2012, this is kind of what happened, right? So the department was created, and all of the other immigration agencies were kind of resettled in one of these. And so that's kind of what the act really did. It also really changed the immigration issue to be more about border security and protecting the country from terrorist attacks. And so we see how immigration has really changed from being, you know, more welcoming to allow people, to come to the U.S. to being more about border security or being more about a national kind of security type of issue, right? And so more recently, the last two things that I wanted to talk about was that in 2006, we had the Secure Fence Act, which allowed a border fence along the U.S.-Mexico border. So there is already a fence and a wall that are part of the U.S.-Mexico border. It has been there now for quite some time. And then the last thing is the executive order, which this is not a law, but I did want to highlight just because it's something that's happened fairly recently. It's a deferred action for childhood arrivals and DACA program, which again, it didn't change someone's immigration status, but it is kind of a pathway to be able to pass legislation that would enable for a road to citizenship for folks who have been here for quite some time, right? So those are some of the things that I wanted to highlight at the federal level. Just things that have happened, right, since kind of the foundation of the country, more or less. The next thing that I wanted to highlight were some kind of anti-immigration legislation that has happened at the state levels. In 2008, South Carolina became the first state to ban undocumented students from public institutions. And after South Carolina, there were like two other states who completely banned undocumented students from attending public institutions. I think Alabama and Georgia was the other one. And then in 2010, Arizona was really persistent about passing legislation that would pretty much allow local law enforcement to enforce immigration law, which is at the federal level. And so after Arizona passed some of this legislation, a lot of other states started to implement some of this within their own legislation. So Georgia, Alabama, Mississippi also included some of this stuff within their states at different years, but more or less kind of the same type of wording. Specifically, the state of Indiana in 2011 made it illegal to have or use consulates of other countries within the U.S. I do also want to point out that some of these things have changed. Some of them have been challenged primarily by the ACLU and a lot of other advocating organizations for immigrant rights. But some of these things are still remain in place. Specifically, I for sure know that in Georgia, undocumented students can still enroll in public and institutions. I think it's the top five universities within the state. And then with the executive order of DACA in 2012, various states had to change their legislation in terms of who was able to apply for a driver's license or an ID. And so a lot of states ended up changing that and allowed for DACA recipients and even opened it up for the right pool of undocumented folks to be able to apply for driver's licenses and IDs. And more recently, right now in 2017, we see that Texas has a bill that would do similar to what Arizona did in 2010, which is to allow for immigration enforcement at the local level. And then the last thing is that some states also have banned undocumented students from receiving in-state tuition, in-state tuition, Arizona, Colorado, and Georgia. And also Indiana. And so you really see kind of, I mean, I didn't want to take it too far back at the state level, but just so you all see that, you know, historically there has been a lot of legislation that has been really anti-immigrant, and even more recently at the state and local level, that those things continue to happen today, right? But what I do want to highlight is some things that have happened at the local level, even at the state level, this whole initiative of sanctuary cities or welcoming cities that has been widely kind of reported on. And so basically, it's kind of a coalition of cities that have said, you know, we welcome immigrants or we will not enforce immigration, enforce any immigration related things here at the local level. So Oregon passed some legislation on that in 1887, and they've just kind of kept that up for quite some time. The city of Seattle signed an executive order as a welcoming city as well last year. And just recently, I think like last week or the week before, California became a sanctuary state. So they said basically that the whole state is now going to enforce immigration and do any immigration enforcement, and so no public resources from the state are going to be used to enforce any of that, right? But at the same time, a lot of states have allowed for undocumented students to receive in-state tuition, and some states like California and Washington allow for students to apply for in-state financial aid. I'm sure there's other states, but those are the ones that I'm most familiar with. So, you know, some things are still happening at the local and at the state level of advocating for folks, right? So those are some of the things that I kind of wanted to share with you all. I know it's a lot of information, and by no means is this all of the information, but I kind of wanted to just give you all some examples of things that have happened in the past, things that are still happening, a little bit about the immigration system, and the different agencies that kind of make up the immigration system, and specifically who undocumented folks are, because that's usually the right now the population that's being really targeted within the government that we have at the moment. So do you all have any questions? Any feedback? Would you like me to clarify something?
Two quick clarifications, just a little confusion in your history slides. I think you show Colorado as both not allowing in-state tuition for undocumented people and allowing it.
Yeah, so I'm not sure if Colorado is one of the states that had already, they had proposed the legislation first, and then it was repealed or challenged in court, and so then they got rid of it.
Second question is, you may want to go back to the slide where you have the history, and I'm curious about what happened in Indiana. I don't understand that. Oh, there you go. There. I don't understand that.
So basically, they had introduced some legislation to make it illegal to have or use consulates of other countries. So, for example, if you have a consulate or an ID from Mexico, if you're a Mexican citizen, and then you want to use that as your form of identification, then they didn't allow for that.
So consulate is a piece of paper. I always think of it as a building where you go and visit a consulate.
That is also.
So was it illegal to go in the consulate for some reason?
No, it's just to have the IDs, to have either to have IDs or to use them as your form of identification.
Yeah,
so as I said, you know, what I wanted to show in this slide was primarily, yeah, that a lot of states have kind of started to do some of these things. As I said earlier, some of the things have already been challenged or kind of gotten rid of. But the ACLU has really great press releases, videos, a lot of background information, court cases that they reference with a lot of these legislation that have happened in a lot of the states. Thank you. Any other questions?
So the sanctuary cities, just I think I understand, so like Seattle as opposed to Arizona as a state, Seattle is saying no public resources. We're not actively, or can be used for immigration, as opposed to Arizona, who is actively using their resources to pursue immigration issues, even at a local level.
Yes.
Is that the gist of the sanctuary city?
Right. I mean, there's a few other things that are involved, but those are kind of the main things. Is one that municipalities won't use local resources to enforce federal laws, which immigration is part of the federal law. So just saying that the local law enforcement won't ask for proof of citizenship if you're pulled over for running a stop sign or anything like that. It also includes other things like, you know, for the city of Seattle specifically, they've said that they will not request any type of citizenship status if you're just enrolling for a class that is offered at a community center up to, you know, anything else of law enforcement, you know, doing their job. And so it really ranges in the different things that they say they wouldn't do, but it's primarily that they won't cooperate with, specifically with ICE, but in immigration enforcement agency to enforce immigration laws.
And then I've heard also about college campuses declaring that we are a sanctuary. So is that just kind of an extension of, even if they are already in a sanctuary city, or if they are not in a sanctuary city, what does that mean?
Well, I think what it means is that in some ways every entity has to kind of come out and say, you know, we're a welcoming institution. For the state, what I do know is that in the state of Washington, even though it's not hasn't committed or passed any legislation that says that there'll be a whole sanctuary state, they have said, you know, through the Attorney General that they will not cooperate with enforcing immigration law, and that folks at any public institution, whether it's a library, a school, a college, anything like that, that they have also the right to inform folks about knowing their rights, And that they also can create a plan to direct immigration enforcement to a specific person or office, but not, you know, go in and investigate everything. So they have had some reports and some guides that they've released that have a lot of great information with the plan. Is that clear?
Yeah.
And I think I've shared, you might have been in some of the presentations that I did previously that has the Attorney General's report. It's very long, but you know, if you do find it, pages like 33 to 43 are the ones that pertain specifically to higher education institutions.
I noticed in your list of different kinds of undocumented status, you mentioned refugee and asylum as different. So what's the difference?
Good question. So I wanted to explain that a little bit. So refugees typically are folks who request are requesting the U.S. to be able to come into the country as with a refugee status. So that application process usually happens within their own country, or if they're at a refugee camp at a different country. Whereas asylum seekers are usually folks to come to one of our borders and they are requesting to seek asylum within the country. So I think it's more about like the processes a little bit, but refugees are seen a little bit more as humanitarian work, as asylum a bit, but you know, the difference of why folks are fleeing their own country really varies. So they're very legal, technical things. That's usually what it is. Yeah. Any other questions?
Just a comment in follow-up to your question about, and your answer about public institutions. Medicine in the U.S. is intensely conservative historically. The American Medical Association is very conservative. Finally, this week in their major organ, they're beginning to discuss the issue of sanctuary hospitals, in which this same sort of solution that healthcare professionals, if ICE officers arrive, do not allow access to bedsides or anybody who's in the hospital. They're just beginning to talk and they're very conservative, but it's interesting that the sanctuary movement has gotten that much impetus that it has begun to affect even such a strongly conservative.
Yeah, and I mean, with that, I do want to mention that that ICE does have a policy that says that they won't go into certain spaces like churches, schools, hospitals, and places like that. Although the policy can be, you know, so a lot of legal organizations have said that the policy can either them not follow through with it, or it can be removed without much public knowledge. And so because, again, immigration has really been pushed to be a national security issue, like a lot of these things, you know, are not really followed through. And ICE is going to do, you know, what they have to do within their reason and how they decide to do things. But the policy, I believe it is still in place.
Apparently there have been at least some episodes.
No, yeah. I mean, things have happened. We've heard about it in the news, but just so you all know that there is a policy that is still in
place. I think we're at time. So thanks, Zahira, for... Thank you all for coming to our weekly Conversations on Social Issues event in the library. I just have a couple things to say before we wrap up. One, there's several books on our topic for the day up here, so if you want to grab one on your way out, you can check it out at the circulation desk. And a couple other things. There's an event tomorrow. Miguel Fraga, First Secretary of the Cuban Embassy, will speak on current issues such as the U.S. economic blockade. That's in room 1110 tomorrow at noon. So if you're interested in that, you should go to that. And then next week, our COSI event will be Beneath the Surface, Heroin in Your Neighborhood with Jay Scott, who is a Seattle Central student. So feel free to join us for that. And if you have an idea in mind for presenting a COSI topic, let me know after this event. Thank you all for coming. I'm going to pass, oh, and we have surveys, so if you can complete one, I'm going to pass these out.